The congregation shivered in the cold. Notre Dame echoed with the sounds of 400 musicians and singers. The young man, born on the island of Corsica, moved impatiently forward. Napoleon Bonaparte, 35 years old, was about to be crowned Emperor of France. "I found the crown of France in the gutter," he said, "and I picked it up." It was December 2nd, 1804. Within 3 years, Napoleon's conquest would extend his empire across almost all of Europe, and he would rule over 70 million people. Not since the ancient Caesars had one man held so much power.
Napoleon changed the world. Here is a man who rises not on the basis of his blood, not on the basis of his background, but on the basis of his ability. No one else has appeared like him, has dominated the world like he has.
Qu'est-ce que Napoleon?
What is Napoleon?
C'est une main.
It's a hand in a shirt.
C'est un
it's a strange hat.
C'est bizarre. Si vous mettez ce
if you show the hat, si if you show the hand in the shirt, in Japan, the United States, or France, everybody will say Napoleon.
Napoleon.
He was above all ambitious. He loved power. He said, "I love power like a musician loves his music."
Napoleon mounted the steps to the altar alone. Seizing the crown in his own hands, he held it aloft. Then brought it to rest on his own head. That morning, he had quietly told his brother, "If only our father could see us now." In the spring of 1769, Letizia and Carlo Bonaparte were crossing the mountains that straddled the interior of the island of Corsica. They were Corsican patriots, determined to repel a French army that had invaded their tiny island nation.
The Corsicans were only about 100 to 120,000 people of peasant or shepherd origin. They had very few firearms, very little gunpowder, and that was all. They had to defend themselves against the 22 million population of France, then the most advanced country in Europe.
The Corsicans never stood a chance. After a year of fighting, leaving thousands dead and wounded, they were defeated, and Letizia and Carlo were going home. Letizia was 6 months pregnant.
Salve Santa Barbara.
That summer, Letizia was celebrating the Feast of the Assumption when she felt her first labor pains. Later that day, August 15, 1769, she gave birth to a son, Napoleone. Napoleone Bonaparte. Born just after the bitter French conquest, Napoleon would spend his childhood hating France, the nation he would one day rule. "I was born when Corsica was perishing," Napoleon later wrote. 30,000 Frenchmen spewed onto our shores, drowning the throne of liberty in waves of blood. The cries of the dying, the groans of the oppressed, and tears of despair surrounded my cradle from the hour of my birth. Corsica was now a French colony. Suspended in the Mediterranean between France and Italy, for centuries Corsicans had fiercely resisted invaders, Romans, Moors, Genoese. After the French victory, Corsican rebels fled to the mountains, where they continued to fight on. But Napoleon's father, Carlo, a 23-year-old university student, readily submitted. Soon he was wearing powdered wigs, embroidered waistcoats, and silver-buckled shoes. Napoleon never forgave him for betraying his Corsican heritage. He would later say harshly that his father was rather too fond of pleasure.
I think Napoleon always held a grudge against his father for having submitted. But poor Carlo, he knew he had lost the battle. He realized the French were there, so he had to live with them and make the best of it.
Carlo began practicing law, won election to the Corsican Assembly, and rose in the esteem of the French rulers. But Napoleon rarely had a good thing to say about him. He saved his praise for his mother. The beautiful, strong-willed Letizia. As a mother, he would say, she was without equal.
He was obsessed by her, fascinated by her, praised her enormously. She was a very tough and determined little woman. 13 times pregnant, she had 8 surviving children. He says that all his success in life was due to the training she gave him.
La mère.
The mother. What a man, Napoleon said. She has the head of a man on the body of a woman.
Carlo and Letizia owned a house in the country as well as one in the city, a mark of their status. They were Corsican aristocrats, but they were not rich. With 8 children, they struggled just to get by on an island that had been impoverished for centuries. There was nothing, the ambitious couple believed, that Corsica could offer them or their children. Only one country could, the country that had vanquished their own, France. As a representative of the Corsican Parliament, Carlo traveled to Versailles. There he saw the splendor of the French court in all its majesty. France was the envy of Europe. Great Britain, Austria, Prussia, Spain, none had more people or greater wealth. While America was just beginning its experiment with democracy, Versailles gave testimony to the power of kings. Carlo was an awestruck provincial. Rumblings of discontent with King Louis XVI and aristocratic privilege were no concern of his. That Queen Marie Antoinette and a frivolous court were draining France of precious resources did nothing to diminish Carlo's delight in everything he saw. He dreamed that one day his children would become noblemen, in that glittering citadel of power in which he had no place. For years, Carlo had nourished a plan. In Versailles, he saw it come true. He secured Napoleon a scholarship to a school in France. Napoleon set foot in France for the first time in the winter of 1778. A thin, sallow 9-year-old, accustomed to the warmth of the Mediterranean, suddenly alone on the windswept plains of northern France. A scholarship boy at the Royal Military College at Brienne-le-Château. He could hardly speak French. For the next 5 years, there would be no holidays, no visits home. He had no love of France. He still thought of himself as a grudging subject of an alien king.
He thinks of himself as a Corsican. He is surrounded by students who are the children of French aristocrats, and they have nothing in common with this little foreigner. And since he is quite proud, he becomes a loner.
Napoleon would one day turn his sympathies toward France, but not without years of resentment and struggle. He was 15 when he was promoted to the Royal Military Academy in Paris. Along with the sons of some of France's greatest families, he would learn the splendors of French civilization. The Royal Academy was as much a finishing school, turning officers into gentlemen, as a war college. "We were magnificently fed and served," Bonaparte said, "treated in every way like officers possessed of great wealth." The poor Corsican teenager still felt like an outsider. He had entered a world of opulence and luxury, but it only served to fuel his scorn for the privilege and snobbery of the French nobility. One teacher described him as quiet and solitary, frightfully egotistical, proud, ambitious, aspiring to everything. He would go far, his school report read, in favorable circumstances. He began his apprenticeship as a soldier when he was 16, a lowly second lieutenant training with the best artillery unit in the French army. He grew expert at sighting a gun, handling rammer and shot, deploying men. One of the greatest careers in military history had begun.
He feels that the regime will not let him have the position he dreams of. The top positions are reserved for the noblemen. While Napoleon comes from minor nobility, poor people.
Frustrated in his military ambitions, Bonaparte dreamed of becoming famous as an author, wrote a brief history of Corsica, even tried his hand at a novel.
He knows that he's capable of great things. He feels that perhaps he's destined for greatness. But at that point, how can he possibly believe it? He's bored to death.
"Always alone among men," Bonaparte wrote, "I come home to dream by myself and to give myself over to all the forces of my melancholy. My thoughts dwell on death. What fury drives me to wish for my own destruction? No doubt because I see no place for myself in this world." It was the revolution that would set Bonaparte free. On July 14th, 1789, Paris erupted. Angry crowds stormed through the streets, crying liberty, equality, brotherhood. France was thrown into turmoil. The monarchy itself tottered on the edge of destruction. A defiant National Assembly challenged the absolute right of the king, stripped nobles and clergy of their ancient feudal privileges, fracturing a social order that had endured for centuries. After years of injustice and inequality, the revolution had begun. It would take years before it would end. As the revolution gained momentum, Bonaparte was serving in the army far from Paris. He distrusted the violent mobs, but welcomed the changes transforming the country.
He is certainly not a revolutionary before the beginning of the revolution. But Bonaparte welcomes the revolution as good news. It almost has a religious impact for him, because all of a sudden he feels that the revolution is going to open up French society.
La révolution va ouvrir la société française. L'abolition des privilèges, le fait que la société française ne va plus connaître.
It would abolish privileges, put an end to hierarchies and the kind of condescension from which Napoleon had suffered while he was growing up. Bonaparte was a man of his times, and to be 20 years old in 1789 is very important. Napoleon's destiny and the destiny of the whole country become the same.
In the summer of 1792, Bonaparte was on leave in Paris and witnessed the last gasp of the French monarchy. In June, a mob stormed the Tuileries Palace and forced the king to wear the red revolutionary bonnet. In August, the mob massacred the king's Swiss guard. King Louis XVI was dethroned. French Republic was proclaimed that fall.
Napoleon wants to be part of this new world. He wants to play a role. And he starts in a place he knows very well. He starts with Corsica.
Donc il commence par la Corse.
Bonaparte was 23, an idealistic revolutionary, when he took leave of absence from the French army and returned to Corsica. The French Republic had made Corsica a part of France and given Corsicans all the rights and liberties of French citizens. Bonaparte, a lieutenant in the island's National Guard, threw himself into Corsican politics. Pasquale Paoli was the island's governor. Paoli had been Bonaparte's childhood hero, the leader of the Corsican War against France. Now Bonaparte dreamed of rising to power, standing by Paoli's side. But he would be bitterly disappointed. Paoli did not trust him. A ragazzone in esperto, Paoli called him. A big, inexperienced boy. The Corsican patriot thought Bonaparte too ambitious, too self-centered, too sympathetic to France.
Bonaparte and Paoli are on totally different wavelengths. Paoli retains the idea that Corsica should be independent. By this time, Napoleon Bonaparte is perfectly comfortable with a Corsica that is part of revolutionary France. Adieu, Corsica,
Bonaparte soon became the leader of a faction opposed to Paoli. Clan rivalry ran deep on the island, intensifying the political struggle between the two men. Paoli's partisans and Bonaparte's were soon at war. In the end, Paoli proved too strong. Bonaparte's home was sacked, and he was forced to flee to the mountains. The Corsican assembly declared Bonaparte and his entire family traitors and enemies of the fatherland, condemned to perpetual execration and infamy. Bonaparte no longer had the right to live in Corsica. He had been given a death sentence by his own people. His idealism shaken, Bonaparte wrote his brother, "Among so many conflicting ideas, the honest man is confused and distressed. Since one must take sides, one might as well choose the side which is victorious. Considering the alternative, it is better to eat than be eaten." The defeat in Corsica, the break with his hero Paoli, had toughened him, made him shrewd, and turned him toward France.
From the time when there is this breakup with Paoli's Corsica, he is French. He wants to be French. He is French.
On June 10, 1793, he set sail for France with his widowed mother, three brothers, and three sisters, a refugee family carrying with them all they owned in the world. 24 years old, he was banished from the land of his birth forever. Bonaparte returned to France to find the French fighting among themselves. The king had been executed. The queen and thousands more followed him to the guillotine. There were cities in revolt, uprisings in the provinces. Maximilien Robespierre was in charge now. The austere, moralizing leader suspended the Constitution, vowing to save the Republic from its enemies at any cost. The revolution turned into the terror. Torn by civil war, France was also at war with almost all of Europe. Austria, Spain, Prussia, and Great Britain were bent on destroying the new French Republic, while French radicals promised to help all peoples rise against their rulers. Reinstated in the army as an artillery captain, Bonaparte was ordered to Toulon, a city of 28,000 on the southern coast that had rebelled against the Republic, throwing its port open to the English. The British fleet defended the city from the harbor. 24-year-old Bonaparte thought he knew how to drive them out. He argued that if his soldiers could seize the heights commanding the harbor, they could bombard the fleet, drive it away, and the city would fall. It was a simple plan, but none of the generals would listen.
The generals in Toulon were total incompetence, or a little worse. Finally, a fairly competent general showed up, listened to Napoleon's plans, and said, "Naturally."
This would be Bonaparte's first great chance. With aristocratic officers fleeing the country, there was suddenly a vacuum, an opportunity for rapid promotion for soldiers who could prove themselves under fire. Bonaparte fought bravely, leading his men in the assault on the fort guarding the heights, suffering a wound in the thigh from an enemy bayonet. 10 ships went up in flames. The British fled. Toulon was recaptured and Bonaparte promoted. In just 3 months, he had risen from captain to brigadier general. The Republic continued to fight for its life, still clashing with enemies beyond its borders, still in turmoil at home. With France in chaos, threatened on all sides, Robespierre showed no mercy in his efforts to bring about unity and order. Liberty, he said, cannot be secured unless criminals lose their heads. Determined to make his voice heard, Bonaparte wrote a political tract in support of Robespierre. The young soldier hated the terror, but he hated chaos even more.
Bonaparte is really a man of order. For him, order has to serve ideals, exactly the idea of Robespierre. It is necessary to suspend liberties in the name of liberty. In order to save liberty, to save the Republic, it's necessary to suspend individual liberties.
In the summer of 1794, Robespierre's government fell. Now it was the turn of those who made the terror to die, including Robespierre. In the spring of 1795, Bonaparte headed for Paris. Now a brigadier general, he was determined to rise still higher. France had a new constitutional government. The guillotine, the riots in the street, the war still raging along the frontier, all seemed forgotten. Bonaparte frequented the salons where the women who dominated Paris society held court. "The women here," he wrote his brother, "are the center of importance. Here, alone of all places on earth, they appear to hold the reins of government." But they wanted little to do with him. He was just another ambitious young soldier. "I can still picture him," one noblewoman remembered. "He wore badly made dirty boots and a nasty round hat pulled down over his eyes. An overall sickly effect was created by this thinness and his yellow complexion." Bonaparte seemed to have come to a dead end. He was desperate for promotion, but no one paid any attention. "If this continues," he wrote his brother, "I shall end by not stepping aside when a carriage rushes past." Then political turmoil once again gave him his chance. On October 5th, 1795, crowds of Parisians stormed through the streets alongside National Guardsmen bent on restoring the monarchy. The rebellion threatened to topple the Republic. The government called on Bonaparte to repel the attack.
There wasn't much other choice, actually, when this rebellion broke. There aren't any competent generals in Paris. Here's young Bonaparte. He's a man of conviction. Put him in.
Napoleon was not one to pussyfoot around. He would use all his weapons. Nobody had really used cannon on the Paris mobs before. He was going to shoot. He waited till he could see the whites of their eyes.
"The enemy attacked us," Bonaparte wrote his brother. "We killed a great many of them. Now all is quiet. I could not be happier." Three weeks later, he was made a full general, commander of the Army of the Interior. He was 26. Bonaparte was now a man to be reckoned with. He was driving through Paris in a fine carriage, wearing new clothes, drenching himself in eau de cologne. The unsophisticated general was no ladies' man, but he had fallen in love. Her name was Marie Joseph Rose de Beauharnais. Everyone called her Rose. Bonaparte called her Josephine. She was a Creole aristocrat from the French colony of Martinique, a 32-year-old widow with two small children, deep in debt, trying to make her way in Paris alone. Languid, with a nonchalant shading into indolence, she was known as a woman of refinement, charm, and grace. It was said that she even went to bed gracefully. Bonaparte was dazzled by her. "I was naturally timid among women," he said. "Madame de Beauharnais was the first woman who gave me any degree of confidence."
Josephine was what might be called a slightly fast woman. She'd been married young. Her husband had died in the guillotine. She'd had an affair with somebody that helped her out. And it was well known she had affairs with men in high French society.
No one stood higher than Paul Barras, the most powerful figure in the new government. Josephine was his mistress, a woman of influence in the most fashionable salons in Paris.
Bonaparte saw her in a world of power. She was at the center of society. She had all these connections. She was very much someone who could be useful to him. And then I think he just fell madly in love with her.
Josephine lived in a little cottage set in a pleasant garden. Some said it was Barras who paid the rent. But Barras was growing tired of her. Now, Bonaparte visited her there. Josephine seemed amused by her new lover. Although she knew how to please him, she did not return his passion. When Bonaparte proposed marriage, she hesitated.
She wasn't attracted to him at all. In fact, she told a friend later that she, for a long time, she had to overcome a feeling of repugnance. He was so serious and he had no sense of humor. He was skinny. His hair was kind of hanging and he was unkempt.
Mais elle sait que la beauté passe.
But she knows her beauty is vanishing. Already her teeth are bad, she's getting wrinkles. Napoleon doesn't see it, but others see it, and she sees it.
Her looks fading and her debts mounting, she needed a protector. On March 9th, 1796, Napoleon Bonaparte and Josephine de Beauharnais were married. A gold-enameled medallion was the general's wedding gift to his bride. On it were inscribed the words, "To Destiny." Bonaparte was sent to the Italian Alps. Josephine's former lover, Paul Barras, had helped win him an appointment as supreme commander of all French forces in Italy. His assignment was to challenge the Empire of Austria and their Italian allies. He had never commanded an army before. Young and untested, no one expected very much from him, especially his own generals.
Tout le monde l'attend avec un peu de moquerie.
Everyone makes fun of him before he gets there. This little general who perhaps owes his command to his wife.
Aux grâces largement données de sa femme. Or, il arrive.
Then he arrives, and within a few moments, the veterans who made fun of him understand exactly. He is in charge.
Il est le chef.
"I don't know why," one of his generals said, "but the little bastard scares me." Bonaparte's army was in no condition to win battles. It had been stagnating under incompetent commanders in the foothills of the Alps for almost 2 years. "Soldiers," he proclaimed, "you are naked and ill-fed. No fame shines upon you. I will lead you into the most fertile plains in the world. Rich provinces, great cities will lie in your power. You will find there honor, glory, and riches.
He really enthralls them. He's a terrific actor.
He
is capable of laughing, smiling, and then suddenly he is passionate, inspiring fear, horror, and anger.
On April 2nd, 1796, Bonaparte led his army forward. He was badly outnumbered. 38,000 French soldiers faced 38,000 Austrians and their allies, 25,000 Piedmontese. Bonaparte planned to isolate the Austrians from the Piedmontese, then conquer each separately. He would strike first at Piedmont. In just 2 weeks, he won six battles, took thousands of prisoners, and broke the back of Piedmont's army. One Piedmontese officer would later complain, "They sent a young madman who attacks right, left, and from the rear. It's an intolerable way of making war." On April 26th, Piedmont surrendered. Bonaparte demanded gold and silver and paid his troops, the first real money they had seen in years. "Soldiers," he said, "we thank you." While Bonaparte led his soldiers into battle, he never stopped thinking of Josephine, writing her letter after letter, day after day. "Not a day goes by without my loving you," he wrote her. "Not a night without holding you in my arms. I curse the glory and ambition which keeps me from the soul of my life. Whenever I am troubled as to how things will turn out, I put my hand to my heart where throbs your likeness. I have but to look at it, and my love is perfect happiness." Josephine would sometimes read his letters aloud to friends. "Bonaparte," she told them, "is so amusing." With Piedmont defeated, Bonaparte was now pursuing the Austrians, who retreated to the east, bewildered by the 26-year-old general and his new way of making war.
In the 18th century, there were nobles commanding on both sides, and they had a certain code. The armies would maneuver, and very often, if one had the other in check, that would be the end of it. There would be no fight. Napoleon was, in a way, the first modern general. He did not accommodate those old codgers on the other side at all.
He attacks every day. He attacks when it snows, he attacks at night, he attacks when it's cold. It's not the way the game is played. He looks for the enemy, fights it, and when they assume that he's going to stop, he continues. The next day, he fights again. It surprises them.
As the Austrians fled, their rear guard hoped to slow Bonaparte down by making a stand at the little Italian town of Lodi. They fortified a narrow wooden bridge with 14 cannon and three battalions and dared Bonaparte to cross it. The general ordered a simple frontal assault on the bridge. Everything would depend on the courage of his men. He had earned their admiration with his rapid string of victories. Now he would find out if he also had their faith.
How do you incite men to do something like that? It's charisma. I mean, he got tremendous presence. Napoleon was a master at motivating his soldiers.
Victory always goes a long way. The more they win, the harder they get to stop. His troops were pretty well hepped up. They'd been chasing Austrians now for weeks, and they went forward.
There are no tactics at all.
The
troops come in so enthusiastically and quickly, it surprises the enemy. It's just a question of enthusiasm. Everyone throws themselves into it. Everyone risks death.
With his men facing withering enemy fire, Bonaparte was in the thick of it.
He was actually up there laying in the cannon, which is a corporal's job. But he was always up there with them.
This is a man with absolute courage. He's wherever he's needed. If he's needed up at the very front to encourage people, he's there.
He takes physical risks. Even if cannonballs fall close to him, and this happened on several occasions, he's not afraid.
The French made it halfway across the bridge and fell back under a vicious hail of fire. Then, one last charge, and they were across. The Austrian guns fell silent.
Here they thought they were safe behind the river, holding the bridge, and all at once the French come across to the bridge and beat the living Jesus out of them. It's a real spectacular job. It wasn't a big battle. The casualties were not particularly heavy, but he had imposed his will on his own men and the enemy, both.
It was not a great victory. The Austrian army had, in fact, escaped. But Bonaparte had won the respect and devotion of his men.
He came out all sweaty and grimy and covered with gun smoke. The troops liked that. They began calling him the little corporal right there. It was, you identify with us, you're our corporal.
This is the moment when he becomes convinced that he has a lucky star. And that destiny has chosen him to accomplish great things.
They haven't seen anything yet, Bonaparte told one of his generals. In our time, no one has the slightest conception of what is great. It is up to me to give them an example.
There was a spark.
The battle at Lodi convinced Napoleon Bonaparte that he was a man of destiny. From that moment, he said, I foresaw what I might be. Already I felt the earth flee from beneath me, as if I were being carried into the sky.
Thank you.
On May 5th, 1796, Bonaparte led his victorious armies into Milan. He was greeted by the Milanese as a heroic liberator, the general who freed them from their Austrian rulers. "We come to break your chains," Bonaparte proclaimed. "Our only quarrel is with the tyrants who have enslaved you." He was more than a general now. He had made himself the head of a provisional Italian government. With an exalted sense of his own destiny, he was determined to follow his star to the heights of power. "Great men become great because they have been able to master luck," Bonaparte said. What the vulgar call luck is a characteristic of genius. "I shall be frantic if I do not have a letter from you tonight," Bonaparte wrote Josephine. Bonaparte desperately wanted his wife to join him in Italy, but Josephine refused to leave Paris. She was spending her time with a dapper young army lieutenant.
Elle trompe Napoléon.
She's cheating on Napoleon with a young officer, infinitely more seductive than Napoleon.
Elle n'est pas à l'époque.
She's not in love with Napoleon. She's afraid she'll be bored in Italy, because in Paris it's a life of parties, a life of luxury.
Finally, after weeks of Bonaparte's pleading letters, Josephine left Paris for Italy. She wept, wrote one witness, as though she were going to a torture chamber. She arrived at Milan's Serbelloni Palace to find that her husband had filled it with flowers in her honor. There they spent the third night of their married life together. After 48 hours, Bonaparte went back to doing what he did best, making war. The Austrian army with fresh reinforcements was still a threat. Now, Bonaparte dealt them a series of crushing blows. Finishing them off in January 1797 in a three-day battle at Rivoli, 60 miles west of Venice. His victories in Italy began the legend of his invincibility, immortalized in a series of romantic paintings. Bonaparte was not only a warrior, he was also a shrewd propagandist.
Bonaparte, dès ses premiers succès,
from his first triumphs, Bonaparte understood that it's not enough to win victories.
Il utilise l'image.
He uses images to make sure that his victories in Italy are widely publicized in France. He understood that art is also a means of propaganda. He orders a painting after a victory. He dictates the theme, the layout of the characters. He even orders the dimensions of the frame. From the very beginning, Napoleon gave himself an image.
Il a d'emblée arrangé.
He created his own history.
Il crée une presse.
He created his own newspapers, France and the Army of Italy, and the newspaper of the Army of Italy, which exalt his victories. Bonaparte himself actually wrote some articles. He himself wrote, "Bonaparte flies like lightning and strikes like a thunderbolt."
Bonaparte vole comme l'éclair et frappe comme la foudre.
While Bonaparte's fame grew in France, he was wearing out his welcome in Italy. When he met armed resistance, he ordered towns sacked, villages burned, rebels shot. Many Italians now began doubting the general, who said he fought in the name of liberty, but was sending convoys of gold and silver back to his government in France, along with some of the great treasures of Italian art. Works by Michelangelo, Titian, Raphael, the four ancient bronze horses from St. Mark's Basilica in Venice. All would soon find a home in a new museum in Paris that would one day be called the Louvre. While he ruled in Italy, Bonaparte never stopped chasing Austrians. Just 2 months after his victory at Rivoli, he had driven them from northern Italy, crossed the Alps into Austria itself, and by April 7, 1797, was within 75 miles of Vienna. Stunned by the advancing French armies, the Austrian emperor sued for peace. Bonaparte himself negotiated with the Austrian diplomats. He wanted Belgium, the left bank of the Rhine, and a new republic to be allied with France carved out of northern Italy. When the Austrians objected to his demands, he turned on them in a rage. He flung to the ground a treasured porcelain tea service. "This is what will happen to your empire," he shouted. "Your empire is nothing but an old maid servant, accustomed to being raped by everyone." Bonaparte, the Austrian delegation reported to Vienna, had behaved like a madman.
There are a lot of legends about this.
Napoléon était un être colérique.
Napoleon was hot-tempered, sometimes with violent physical reactions. And when the negotiations dragged on too long, Napoleon became agitated, started pacing back and forth, smacked into a small table, and overturned a tea service.
Whether by rage, insult, or shrewd diplomacy, Bonaparte got what he wanted. And he had dictated the terms of the treaty himself, without instructions from the government in Paris.
He saw that his intelligence, his abilities, were more than just military. He had become not only a great general, but also possibly a future statesman. And everybody realizes it, not only in Italy, but in France.
At the end of 1797, 28-year-old Napoleon Bonaparte returned to Paris and handed the government a treaty which brought a fragile peace to the continent of Europe. Now, only Great Britain remained at war with France. In just 1.5 years, he had taken his dispirited, tattered soldiers, marched them hundreds of miles, and defeated the army of the Empire of Austria without ever losing a battle. The French were hungry for a hero, someone who could put an end to the political chaos into which the revolution had descended. One government after another had come and gone. Now they lived under a new one, the Directory. The Directory was an unstable, fragile parliamentary government that commanded no confidence. All of France turned toward Bonaparte, wondering what he would do next. "What I have done up to now is nothing," he said privately. "I am only at the beginning of the course I must run. I can no longer obey. I have tasted command, and I cannot give it up." While Bonaparte waited for the right moment to seize power, he set his sights on new glories in the exotic East. He eluded a British fleet, and on July 1, 1798, landed with 35,000 soldiers in Egypt. France was still at war with Great Britain, and Bonaparte hoped to disrupt British trade routes to India. In 1798, Egypt was still a source of wonder to most Europeans. The souks crowded with Turks and Jews, Syrians and Greeks. The minarets sounding the call of an alien religion. The Sphinx with its broken nose buried in the sand up to its neck.
Bonaparte finds himself in a country of legends, myths, and a great history. But it was really madness on his part, because all of the military calculations at the time held that it was impossible for a European army to conquer the East.
Bonaparte quickly captured Alexandria. And then on July 3rd, led his soldiers across the desert toward Cairo. And a looming battle. For centuries, the Egyptians had been part of the Turkish Empire, ruled by the fiercest warriors in the Middle East, the Mamluks. Remarkable for their courage, pride, and cruelty, the Mamluks waited fearlessly for the French armies. One Mamluk prince called them donkey boys.
The Mamluks charged a cannon with their sabers and their horses, with arms from the Middle Ages. It was a meeting between the Europe of the future and the Egypt of the past.
Napoleon just organized his army into five gigantic squares. These are men kneeling and standing and firing. So you've got a continual rolling fire. The Mamluks rode around the squares and were shot at by that square and by this square. The French lost 30 men. The Mamluks lost probably 5,000 or 6,000.
The Battle of the Pyramids was over in an hour. 3 days later, Bonaparte led his army into Cairo. "I was full of dreams," he said. "I saw myself founding a new religion, marching into Asia riding an elephant, a turban on my head, and in my hand, the new Quran." But Bonaparte's dreams of empire were quickly shattered. The British Admiral Horatio Nelson caught the French fleet anchored off the Egyptian coast and blew it to pieces. Bonaparte and 35,000 soldiers were trapped in Egypt.
The only link that he had with France were his ships. His fleet of warships. You can imagine what a disaster this was. He was forced to stay in Egypt and live with the Egyptians, to find his bread and water in Egypt, and even find ammunition for his weapons in Egypt, to live in Egypt.
While Bonaparte was marooned in Egypt, his wife was buying a new home. manor house 6 miles from Paris called Malmaison. There, Josephine enjoyed over 300 acres of gardens, woods, and fields, and the companionship of her lover. When an aide dared to tell Bonaparte the truth, the general was crushed. "The veil is torn," he wrote his brother. "I am tired of grandeur. All my feelings have dried up. I no longer care about my glory. At 29, I have exhausted everything." Furious, he took the wife of one of his officers for a mistress. His friends called her the general's Cleopatra. Cut off from France, Bonaparte remained undaunted. Installed in a palace in Cairo, he imagined himself an Eastern potentate, following in the footsteps of Alexander the Great.
He came to Egypt at the head of an army, and suddenly he found himself at the head of a nation. And it's not just any nation. It's Egypt.
C'est l'Égypte.
Egypt was an enigma to Europeans. Bonaparte saw a chance to be the first to unravel its mysteries. Along with his army, he had brought with him a remarkable group of mathematicians, artists, mapmakers, and engineers. They set about producing a monumental document, a description of Egypt, 24 volumes of text and pictures. They studied the crocodile and the ibis, music and mummies, surveyed temples and tombs, and measured the dimensions of the Sphinx. One scientist found a new species of blue water lily, another an unknown Nile fish. The most dramatic discovery of all was a big black stone with some puzzling inscriptions. The Rosetta Stone would prove to be the key to deciphering Egyptian hieroglyphics.
The monumental volumes that were published by the scientists that went along with Napoleon to Egypt laid the foundation for this study of Egyptology today.
The true conquests, Bonaparte wrote, the only ones that leave no regret are those that have been wrested from ignorance. In February 1799, Bonaparte took 13,000 soldiers into Syria. The Sultan of Turkey had declared war on the French infidels, and Bonaparte went on the offensive. After a quick victory at Jaffa, he assaulted Acre, where he was forced to lay siege to the well-fortified city. Attack after attack failed, claiming the lives of hundreds of French soldiers. Hundreds more were struck down by the bubonic plague. Bonaparte abandoned the siege and retreated to Cairo with a dispirited army of sick and wounded men. But Bonaparte refused to admit the extent of the disaster. "I am returning to Cairo with many prisoners and flags," he proclaimed. "I razed the ramparts of Acre. There is not a stone left standing." On August 23, 1799, Bonaparte secretly set sail for home, abandoning more than 30,000 soldiers with little more than an apologetic message. "Extraordinary circumstances alone have persuaded me to pass through enemy lines and return to Europe." France was once again at war with Austria, Britain, and Russia. civil war continued to tear the country apart. The government in Paris was in disarray. Already, there were rumors of an impending coup. Bonaparte dreamed of rescuing France, but feared he had not moved fast enough. All great events hang by a hair, he told an aide. I believe in luck, but the wise man neglects nothing which helps his destiny. On October 9th, 1799, he landed in France and found himself greeted by cheering crowds. The campaign in Egypt, a military disaster, had been a propaganda triumph.
In the theaters, what's being shown? The expedition to Egypt, the victory of the pyramids. When he arrives, he's considered the man of the hour. His genius was to come to France and say, "You need a savior. Here I am." The French people believed that Napoleon was destined to do great things. In all the engravings of the period, you see the two frigates which brought Napoleon from Egypt. And above the first frigate, a star.
By October 16th, Bonaparte was in Paris. First, he would settle with Josephine. With his steady rise to fame and power, the dynamic between the inexperienced soldier and the sophisticated society woman had shifted. Bonaparte was determined to divorce his wife. He returned home, locked himself in his room, and refused even to see her. "I will never forgive her," he said. "Never." But Josephine was just as determined to win him back. She climbed the stairs to his room and begged him to let her in.
Bonaparte puts his fists in his ears. He refuses to hear her, and she bangs on the door and cries, "I have loved only you." But Bonaparte kept saying, "No, no, no."
Napoleon is forced to hear his wife crying, begging, swearing that she will never do it again, promising that she will never do it again, but just open the door.
By the time the sun rose, Bonaparte had weakened. The next morning found husband and wife in each other's arms. Josephine would never take a lover again. And while Bonaparte would always insist that he loved her best, he would do as he pleased with other women. Back in France, less than a week, Bonaparte saw that the time had come to act. Solemnly deliberating in the Luxembourg Palace, the Directory was about to be swept aside. The debt from 8 long years of war was mounting. Draft evasion rampant. Bandits roamed the highways and the countryside. The government seemed powerless. Already, there were schemes to overthrow it. As the crisis ripened, Bonaparte determined to find a way to seize power for himself. His moment, he knew, had arrived. He allied himself with one of the plotters, a member of the Directory, Emmanuel Sieyès, who needed the support of the popular young general.
This coup that Sieyès plans is a parliamentary coup, a political coup. Sieyès is in charge, and force will only be used if something goes wrong. General Bonaparte is only supposed to have a supporting role in this coup.
On November 9th, 1799, Bonaparte and Sieyès set their plot in motion.
It's really a very simple premise, that the parliament will put itself out of business. They will vote in a provisional government that will, in effect, start over again, draft a new constitution. They expect that the bayonets will never be unsheathed and a shot will never be fired.
For the coup to have an air of legitimacy, Bonaparte and Sieyès wanted the legislators to vote them into power. They didn't want to seize it. Bonaparte counted on the help of his brother Lucien, who had been elected president of the lower house of the legislature as a result of his brother's popularity. But Lucien was powerless to persuade the council to dissolve the government.
They run into real opposition. The opposition insists that every deputy renew his oath of allegiance to the existing constitution, which they do. It takes over 2 hours to do this. Meanwhile, the key plotters waiting outside in the wings, as it were, are getting very agitated, and particularly General Bonaparte, who eventually just loses patience and decides that he must intervene to speed things up. He enters the legislative house. This is strictly against the law. The legislature is barred to any outside military figure. And what he encounters there is genuine rage.
The members of the assembly, they see these bayonets and the bearskin hats marching down the main aisle with Bonaparte between them. And they begin to shout and scream, "Outlaw him, outlaw him. He's trying to take over the government." And his brother, Lucien, said, "Wait a minute, my brother's not trying to take over the government. Calm down." And they say, "We want him outlawed, we want him outlawed."
Bonaparte never gets to utter a word to the deputies. And he is, in effect, hustled out by the grenadiers who had come in with him and is quite badly shaken by this.
Bonaparte had bungled. The coup seemed lost. His chance for power finished. When some of his own soldiers began to doubt their general's intentions, his brother Lucien took control of the chaotic situation.
Lucien sees that Napoleon is going to miss the moment. He has the drums beat. He draws his sword. He walks over to Napoleon. He presses the point of the sword, Napoleon's chest, and he said, "Believe me, soldiers of France, if Napoleon aspired to take over the government, be dictator, I'd run him through."
The soldiers stormed the assembly hall. The cowed legislators fled, some jumping unceremoniously out the windows. At 2 o'clock that morning, a small rump of the council in league with the plotters reassembled and voted into law a new provisional government with three provisional consuls at its head. Bonaparte was one of them.
This triumvirate is only a facade.
Le coup d'état de parlementaire,
the parliamentary coup had become a military coup.
Et l'homme fort qui était,
and the strong man is no longer Sieyès, now it is Bonaparte.
Within weeks, Bonaparte outmaneuvered the other consuls, rewrote the constitution, and made himself head of state under the title First Consul. As the year 1800 began, Napoleon Bonaparte, 30 years old, was the most powerful man in France. "The revolution," Bonaparte said, "is over." And then he added, "I am the revolution." War had catapulted Bonaparte into power. Now, war would help him secure it. France was still fighting Great Britain and Austria. Bonaparte conceived a daring plan to catch the Austrians by surprise. In the spring of 1800, he took his soldiers over the Alps. 40,000 men, field artillery, trekking across treacherous layers of snow and ice through the great St. Bernard Pass. Not since the Carthaginian general Hannibal had an army attempted such an outlandish offensive.
It's 10,500 feet high. They dragged their guns in pine trees, they hauled it out like canoes, and they took off across the mountains.
On May 20th, Bonaparte made the crossing himself. Jacques-Louis David memorialized the adventure in his heroic portrait of Napoleon mounted on a gleaming stallion. In fact, Bonaparte crossed the Alps riding a sure-footed mule. It took the general and his army just 6 days. On the morning of June 14th, he faced the Austrians at Marengo, 45 miles from Milan. By the end of the day, there were 6,000 French casualties, but nearly twice as many Austrians had been killed or wounded. The French had won. "My power depends on my glory," Bonaparte said, "and my glory on my victories." Early the next year, the Emperor of Austria ordered a halt to the fighting and signed a treaty with France. Great Britain followed the year after. For the first time in 10 years, all of Europe was at peace.
Bonaparte had been in power just 6 months, and the people of France had seen other political regimes which had lasted only a year. They said, well, Bonaparte might not last either. After Marengo, things changed. Ordinary people, as well as people in the ruling class, now thought Bonaparte would last.
Now Bonaparte moved to consolidate his rule. At his urging, the French Constitution was again amended, and at 33, Bonaparte became first consul for life, with near dictatorial powers, a king in all but name.
The more power that Bonaparte gets, the more he wants. And it escalates step by step. Never too much at once, always step by step, gradually, and always with Napoleon looking back and saying, remember, I am going to protect the gains of the revolution. They're safe with me.
As the 19th century began, Bonaparte set out to prove that he could govern as well as he could fight. A newborn government, he told his secretary, must dazzle and astonish. He built new parks, bridges and quays along the Seine, canals, reservoirs, and roads. He would make Paris, he said, the loveliest city that ever was or ever could be, and France the greatest country on earth. Launching a series of sweeping political, economic, and legal reforms, he laid the foundation for a new France. All of French society came under his gaze. He set in place a strong, centralized government with a tightly structured, far-reaching bureaucracy, organized a new system of state secondary schools, the lycée, established a central bank, the Bank of France. Slowly, the economy revived, and with it, prosperity. All of Europe was in awe. The great artists and thinkers of the day, Goethe, Hegel, Byron, Beethoven, saw in Bonaparte the embodiment of the ideals and hopes of the revolution. He oversaw the codification of a new system of laws, which abolished feudal privileges and established the equality of every man before the law. Bonaparte's civil code remains the basis of French law to this day. In 1801, Bonaparte signed an agreement with the Pope, the Concordat, making Catholicism the dominant but not exclusive religion of France. He had no personal use for religion, but he understood its political value. "If I governed a nation of Jews," he said, "I should restore the Temple of Solomon. Religion is excellent stuff for keeping common people quiet." Bonaparte ruled with the carrot and the stick. To reward men of accomplishment, he created a special mark of esteem, the Legion of Honor. "My motto has always been," he said, "a career open to all talents, without distinctions of birth." He believed in equality. A man should have the chance to rise on the basis of his ability, just as he had done. But he had no patience with those who demanded liberty. He ruled with an iron hand, crushing anyone who dared speak out against him, making a sham of parliament and free elections. "I had been nourished by reflecting on liberty," Bonaparte said, "but I thrust it aside when it obstructed my path." While Bonaparte ruled France, Josephine gracefully assumed the role of First Lady. But she preferred the quiet seclusion of Malmaison to France's magnificent palaces. In deference to his wife, Bonaparte made Malmaison his countryside seat of government. He worked 7 days a week, often 18 hours a day, month after month. But if it could be said that he ever relaxed, it was at Malmaison with Josephine. In 1803, France was still at peace, and Bonaparte was her absolute master. When he looked across his borders, the only country he had to fear was Great Britain. Britain, with the greatest navy in the world. Britain, immensely rich. France and Great Britain had signed a treaty of peace, but no one expected it to last. Even before the treaty was signed, one observer said, "Peace in a week, war in a month."
England, always England.
There is always a profound antagonism between the sea and the land, between the strength of the continent, represented by Napoleon, and the strength of the sea and international trade, represented by England. It was inevitable that war between France and England would resume.
The treaty is a misnomer. It's really a truce. You still have two great powers at odds with each other, fighting for influence, fighting for supremacy, and they've basically fought to a draw at this point.
On May 18, 1803, when Great Britain declared war on France, few were surprised. The two armies peered at each other across the English Channel, neither willing to risk battle. France held at bay by the British Navy, Britain afraid to send soldiers to fight on the continent. But as Bonaparte waited and readied his troops, his confidence in himself and his star remained unshaken. His victories had already made France larger than it had ever been. He was the most feared man in Europe, and his authority at home remained unchallenged. 34 years old, he was as powerful as any of the Bourbon kings who had come before him. All he lacked was a crown. Now, he decided he wanted one.
He wished to be a king. His idea is that given what France has achieved in the world, it ought to be considered as a kind of empire with Napoleon Bonaparte as the emperor. This would put him on an equal footing with the monarchs of Europe. He would no longer be an upstart, he would be one of the club.
On December 2nd, 1804, the imperial procession made its way through Paris. A Senate proclamation and a vote of the people, both carefully arranged by Bonaparte himself, had given him what he wanted. He was about to become an emperor. As soon as a man becomes a king, he is set apart from all other men, Bonaparte said. I always felt that Alexander the Great's idea of pretending to be descended from a god was inspired by a sure instinct for real politics. In spite of the cold, a 500,000 cheering spectators lined the streets. Bonaparte himself had meticulously planned every detail. The great cathedral, hung with pennants and tapestries and decorated like a Roman temple, seemed more like a theater than a church. But Bonaparte wanted his elevation to glow with the aura of religion. The Pope had been brought from Italy to sanctify the occasion.
He has the genius of making the Pope come to Paris, which gives everything a sacred air. It is God who confirms that the changes that took place during the revolution are forever established.
Slowly, Bonaparte and Josephine walked toward the two thrones that awaited them. His mantle, adorned with gold and precious jewels and weighing 80 pounds, was supported by his brothers. He looked, one spectator said, like a Caesar on a Roman coin. A little more than 10 years before, the French had beheaded a king. Now, they were crowning an emperor. Born upon the great tide of the French Revolution and the wars that followed in its wake, Bonaparte had turned his genius as a general and a statesman to the domination of France. Soon, he would turn toward the conquest of Europe. Already, he was planning an invasion of Great Britain to make him master of the island nation that dared defy him. Confidently, Bonaparte lifted the imperial crown. And brought it to rest on his own head. Then he moved toward Josephine and crowned her his empress. I am the instrument of Providence, Napoleon said. She will use me as long as I accomplish her designs. Then, she will break me like a glass.
Thank you.
The congregation shivered in the cold. Notre Dame echoed with the sounds of 400 musicians and singers. Napoleon Bonaparte was about to be crowned Emperor of France. "If I have any ambition," he said, "it is so natural to me, so intimately linked with my existence, that it is like the blood that circulates in my veins." It was December 2nd, 1804. Napoleon was 35 years old. His faith in his guiding star had been justified. Riding the tide of revolution that shook all of Europe, the young lieutenant from Corsica had ascended to the rank of general, married the woman he loved, Josephine de Beauharnais, and with victory after victory on the battlefield, made himself the most powerful figure in France.
There's this young Corsican bringing whole empires toppling, kings losing their thrones, causing this magical belief in him.
An enormous presence, with a coil spring intensity, like a bomb about to go off when he entered a room.
C'est une ambition en marche.
He is ambition in motion.
À mesure que le temps passait,
as time went by, he only had confidence in himself.
Napoléon va se
considérer. He considered himself invincible.
Napoleon mounted the steps to the altar alone. Seizing the crown in his own hands, he held it aloft. Then brought it to rest on his own head. As 1805 began, Napoleon was planning to cross the English Channel and invade Great Britain with 2,000 ships and 200,000 soldiers. The French and British were at war once again, irreconcilable enemies struggling for dominance on the continent of Europe.
I think Napoleon reckoned that if he got across the Channel, his chances would have been excellent, and he was probably right. We had no army, we had a pathetic army, and Napoleon seemed to be invincible. As he said, if I am master of the Channel for 6 hours, I will be master of the world.
"I will take you to London," he told his Empress Josephine. "I intend the wife of the modern Caesar to be crowned in Westminster." To the British, Napoleon seemed capable of fantastic deeds. He might fly over the Channel or dig a tunnel beneath it. The bogeyman, or bony man as they called him, might be coming any day.
We despised him, and the cartoons at the time were incredibly vicious. Napoleon was portrayed as a little Corsican upstart and Josephine as a tart. He was a little dwarf facing the great might of the British establishment. On the other hand, mothers would tell their children at night, if you don't say your prayers, Boney will come and get you.
But Napoleon needed ships to carry his men across the Channel, and his fleet was no match for the British. the most powerful maritime force in the world.
The Royal Navy was always there, and Napoleon says at one point, in despair, wherever I went, I always found the Royal Navy. And by August of 1805, he realized that the invasion of England was just not on.
At the end of the summer, Napoleon paraded his soldiers along the Channel shore. Then, to everyone's surprise, ordered them to turn their backs on England and march into Europe. Austria and Russia had joined Britain in an alliance to destroy him. Already, tens of thousands of Russian soldiers were lumbering forward to unite with their Austrian allies. Napoleon had inherited the struggle begun over 10 years before, when revolutionary France faced off against the monarchs of Europe who were determined to crush the revolution before it spread.
Napoleon inherited this extraordinary dynamism left over from the French Revolution. Everybody who had a crowned head, they thought, well, you know, what happened to Louis XVI might happen to him.
Napoleon represents the revolution and the expansion of the revolution. Not only the territorial expansion, but the expansion of revolutionary ideas. Napoleon goes into Europe with his bayonets, but also with the civil code.
Restless after long months of waiting, his soldiers were eager to fight. They were superbly disciplined, hardened veterans of the wars in Italy and the Rhineland. Napoleon called them La Grande Armée, the Great Army. They were the most feared men on the continent. They could begin marching well before dawn, and with little rest, continue until nightfall. The emperor has discovered a new way of waging war, one soldier said. He makes use of our legs instead of our bayonets.
Measure yourself carrying between 40 and 60 pounds of rations and musket and cartridges. Most of them are farmers' boys. Grown up used to misery and walking and working from day to night.
And these men would march something like 30 miles in a day. They'd march for 4 hours and stop, and then march another 3 or 4 hours and then stop again. And they would forage as they went. I mean, they would have to worry about these big supply trains behind them.
The Grande Armée was an impressive sight. The splendid uniforms helped a soldier feel stronger, bigger, and braver than he was. Made him forget the brutal facts of warfare. They would fight for riches, the glory of France, and devotion to their emperor.
He said, who is the bravest man in this unit? The officer said, this man. He took the Legion of Honor off his own coat and stuck it on the soldier's uniform. Can you imagine how that would spread in the army?
His soldiers idolized him, eager for just a few words of praise or an even greater tribute saved only for the bravest, an affectionate yank on the ear. He stood 5 feet 2 inches tall. With one hand thrust under his coat, he struck a pose common at the time and made it his own.
His little coat and hat were a kind of propaganda, because he created a simple character, austere but very recognizable.
He appealed to the privates by wearing clothes like that. Here is a man who dresses like we do, like the soldier does, like not like the generals and the marshals, but like us.
Napoleon drove his men hard, but he drove no one harder than himself. He could ride for 10 hours at a stretch, often eating lunch on horseback. He slept in a tent or under the stars, lying down on his camp bed at 8 and rising after only a few hours sleep to spend the rest of the night studying reports and issuing orders. He still found time to write Josephine, reminding her of his love and showering her with kisses everywhere. Summer turned to fall. Napoleon's soldiers marched deeper and deeper into Europe. Waiting were two enemy armies that outnumbered them almost 2-1. The Russians and Austrians planned to defeat the French by sheer force of numbers.
The Russians and the Austrians thought that they would lick him. They were quite convinced that once they got him in the center of Europe, they would finish him off.
But Napoleon saw at once the flaw in the Allied strategy. Their forces were widely dispersed across the continent. By moving quickly, he could strike at the Austrians before the Russians arrived.
Well, he will swing in across Germany and cut off the leading Austrian forces. His plan is just hit first, hit with massed forces, and catch these boys before they can all link up.
In less than 6 weeks, the French reached the Danube, catching the Austrian army of General Karl Mack by surprise. While his enemy wavered, Napoleon struck the decisive blow.
He comes down behind him, and any sensible general would have run. But the Austrian general there, Mack, decided he'd make a fight for it. And so he held his position. Napoleon just whipped his army around him and isolated him and forced him into surrender just in a matter of days.
Men surrendered. Mack had lost almost his entire army. I did not intend to fight any but the English, Napoleon told the defeated Austrian general, until your master came along and provoked me. All empires come to an end. Now, nothing stood between Napoleon and Vienna. I have been rather overdone, my good Josephine. 8 days spent in soaking rain and with cold feet have told on me a little. But I have accomplished my object. I have destroyed the Austrian army by simply marching.
Napoleon, having moved at this great speed, 200,000 men marching 500 miles in 40 days. So there he has already, he's defeated half the Austrian army.
On November 14th, Napoleon led his soldiers into Vienna, capital of the ancient Austrian Empire. The Emperor Francis I had fled, leaving his palaces and gardens to the enemy. As Bonaparte triumphantly paraded through the winding streets, he portrayed himself as the representative of the French Revolution, a symbol of freedom and enlightenment. But many who had once worshipped him had by now changed their minds. including Ludwig Beethoven.
Lorsque Napoléon
When Napoleon decided to make himself emperor, Beethoven denounced him as a vulgar person who lowered himself to the level of an ordinary king.
Beethoven had dedicated his Third Symphony to First Consul Bonaparte. Now he angrily blotted out his name. Emperor Napoleon, he said, is nothing more than an ordinary mortal. He would trample on all human rights and become a tyrant. 2 months before, Napoleon had been encamped on the English Channel. Now the Viennese elders were giving him the keys to their city. But his triumph had been shadowed by a disaster. On October 21st, British Admiral Horatio Nelson had caught a French fleet at Trafalgar and utterly destroyed it at the cost of his own life. Great Britain had lost its greatest sailor. But never again would the French challenge the might of the British Navy. Napoleon no longer had a fleet he could count on. And now, in December 1805, the Grand Army itself was in danger. Although Napoleon had crippled the Austrian army and driven the emperor from Vienna, his conquest threatened to become his undoing.
It is winter, it is December, it is cold. He's surrounded by a hostile population. The Russians are coming to help the Austrians. His troops are dwindling in number and in supplies. He was almost 1,000 miles from Paris.
All of Europe had become a deadly trap. He was deep in the center of the continent. Prussia was now threatening to declare war. And on November 22nd, the Russian and Austrian armies finally united in a single fighting force. 90,000 allies against 75,000 Frenchmen.
You might say any sensible man would have stopped and perhaps done a deal with the Russians and the Austrians. He really had two choices, either to go back or go forward. Napoleon would never go back. So he thought, you know, one more battle.
As November drew to a close, Napoleon roamed the countryside, studied the battles of Frederick the Great, pored over maps. Then he pointed to a spot not far from the little village of Austerlitz. It was a hilly field bounded by woods, marshy ponds, and small towns. Here he would make his stand. Looking it over, the emperor told his marshals, "Gentlemen, examine this ground carefully. It is going to be a battlefield. You will have a part to play upon it." 70,000 Russian soldiers would have a part to play, too. Commanded by the Tsar himself, Alexander I. Just 28, he was eager, one of his aides said, to experience and win a battle. To cover himself with glory by defeating the invincible Corsican upstart. Vain, inexperienced, the young Tsar was an easy target for one of the greatest strategists who ever lived. Napoleon was outnumbered. But if he could control the battlefield, make the Tsar attack him when and where and how he wanted, he had a chance to carry the day. The battlefield at Austerlitz was dominated by a gently sloping hill, the Pratzen Heights. "If I wanted to stop the enemy," Napoleon said, "it is there that I should post myself. But that would lead only to an ordinary battle, and I want decisive success." Napoleon's army controlled the heights, but he would now sacrifice his commanding position in a daring gambit to lure the Russians to attack his right flank. With a thin line of soldiers on his right, he ordered his men to abandon the heights and watched as enemy forces occupied it. Napoleon knew his man. The Tsar called a council of war and argued for an immediate attack. the Russian general Mikhail Kutuzov objected. Blind in one eye from a battle wound, the hard-drinking veteran was contemptuous of his Austrian allies and wary of Napoleon.
Kutuzov tried to calm the Tsar's fervor. He sensed the trap. Perhaps he didn't understand the trap, but he felt it. He was an old fox.
The night before the battle, Napoleon dined on his favorite campaign dish, potatoes fried with onions. All across the French camp, his soldiers settled into their evening chores. He had already inspected the troops and sighted some of the cannon himself. He appeared a model of optimism and confidence. As he rode past his men, they shouted, "Long live the Emperor!" and waved flaming torches. The camp blazed with light. It was December 2nd, 1805, the first anniversary of his coronation. Napoleon told an aide, "This is the finest evening of my life." Daybreak came with an impenetrable fog. The top of the Pratzen Heights floated like an island above the sea of mist. Napoleon's soldiers woke early and shook off hunger and fatigue, each man preparing for a fight he knew might be his last.
The main killer was probably the artillery. You were just blown apart, ripped apart, or had a neat hole put through you. Coming in close, when it did get to bayonet fighting, why, it was usually pretty deadly. More killed than wounded. And there was then, of course, the infantry musket, the heavy lead slugs. Those really smashed and tore. Modern rifle bullet punches a neat hole, but these things just ripped and they shatter bones and take out whole sections of the flesh.
From his command post on the Pratzen Heights, the Tsar, eager for battle, ordered the Allies down off the high ground toward the far end of Napoleon's weak right flank, anchored in the little village of Telnitz. Napoleon had a surprise waiting for them. Two divisions of soldiers he had summoned from Vienna. They had covered the 70 miles in only 2 days. Napoleon had put reinforcements where they were least expected, and faster than anyone thought possible. His troops, exhausted after their long march from Vienna, struggled to hold on. So far, Napoleon said, his enemy was behaving like they were conducting maneuvers on his orders. Napoleon had wanted the enemy to attack his weak right. He now had enough troops to defend it, more than enough for his own plan, an attack on the Pratzen Heights, which was left with few defenders. Napoleon watched from his command post above the battlefield, waiting to spring his trap. Hidden in the haze at the bottom of the valley below the heights were two French divisions, 17,000 men. Napoleon gave the order to advance. One sharp blow, he said, and the war is over. The fog was so dense the French soldiers could barely see 10 paces in front of them. As the sun began to rise, Napoleon's army appeared out of the mist. On the top of the Patzen, the Tsar watched the French materialize out of the valley. "They come out of a clear sky," he told an aide. "Your Majesty," his aide replied, "you should rather say, they come from hell."
Alexander didn't know what to do. He was at an absolute loss. From that moment on, he completely lost control of his army. After the panic on the heights, he no longer participated in the battle.
Finding themselves attacked when they thought that they were the attackers, Napoleon said, they looked upon themselves as half defeated. By 9:30, the French controlled the Pratzen Heights, demolishing the center of the Allied position. Napoleon swept across the battlefield and attacked the Allies from behind. By 5 o'clock, Austerlitz was silent. Nine 9,000 Frenchmen were killed or wounded, along with 16,000 Russians and Austrians. The Tsar and his army retreated. But the Austrian emperor himself, Francis I, came to sue for peace from the little Corsican artillery lieutenant who had made himself an emperor only 1 year before. "A battle was fought today," Francis wrote his wife, "which did not turn out very well." Napoleon wrote Josephine, "I have defeated the Russian and Austrian army commanded by the two emperors. I am a little tired. I embrace you." Austerlitz had raised Napoleon's star to new heights. He had won his greatest victory, the victory of which he would always be the proudest. "Soldiers," he said, "I am pleased with you. You have decorated your eagles with an immortal glory. You will be greeted with joy, and it will be enough for you to say, I was at the Battle of Austerlitz, for people to reply, there goes a brave man." Victory was cause for wild rejoicing. Peace seemed at last assured. Six months later, Napoleon was still deep in Europe, preparing for war again. "Among the established sovereigns," he said, "war aims never go beyond possession of a province or a fortress. With me, the stake is always my existence and that of the whole empire. Conquest alone made me what I am. Conquest alone can keep me there." Alarmed by France's growing power, now the Prussians challenged him. Napoleon made short work of them. The idea that Prussia could take the field against me by herself, he said, seems so ridiculous that it does not merit discussion. In less than 3 weeks, he brought the Prussians to their knees, taking 140,000 prisoners, leaving 25,000 dead or wounded. The might of the Prussian army had been entirely crushed. Napoleon marched triumphantly through Berlin to the strains of the Marseillaise, invoking the revolution, equality, and the abolition of privilege. Now master of most of Western Europe, he swept away feudal laws and forced the nations he had conquered to accept the new ones he had created for France, the Civil Code. But he did not govern in the name of liberty. I have come to realize, he said, that men are not born to be free. Liberty is a need felt by a small class of people whom nature has endowed with nobler minds than the mass of men. He reigned like kings of old, with 44 different palaces, including Fontainebleau. He believed his own glory, the glory of France, and the spirit of the revolution were all one and the same. Like a good Corsican family man, he made his brothers and sisters royalty. Louis became king of Holland, Joseph, king of Naples, Jerome, king of Westphalia. I need my family to stabilize my dynasty, he said. If I distributed thrones according to merit, I should have made different choices. He made Sister Caroline a queen, Pauline a princess, Elisa a duchess. To his mother, he awarded the title Madame Mère.
Napoleon always had a lot of respect for his mother. He always remained his mother's child, even when emperor. She was amazed by the success of her son. And she was afraid it wouldn't last. She was supposed to have often said, in her thick Corsican accent, just as long as it lasts.
While Napoleon spent long months on campaign far from France, Josephine passed the time at Malmaison. She was uncomfortable living in the palaces of the great royal families. I was never made for so much grandeur, she said. I can feel the Queen's ghost asking, what am I doing in her bed? Malmaison was Josephine's refuge. There she tended to her gardens, importing exotic plants, trees, and flowers from all over the world. Although Napoleon was no longer the inexperienced youth intoxicated by her erotic charms, he remained deeply attached to her. He considers me, Josephine told a friend, one of the rays of his star.
Napoleon found in Josephine a woman who met all of his desires. She was an admirable empress. She complimented him. As Napoleon said, I win the wars and she wins people's hearts.
Josephine appeared more in love now than ever before, though she and her husband often quarreled. He objected to her spending, nearly 1 million francs a year on clothes alone. She was jealous of his mistresses. But he made love much the same way he ate his meals, quickly. My mistresses, he said, do not in the least engage my feelings. Power is my mistress. He could not understand why Josephine was upset. She takes things far too seriously, he said. She is always afraid that I shall fall deeply in love. Can she not understand that love is not for me?
They were just passing relationships, and Josephine made more out of them than she should have. In the end, over time, they created a real partnership. They had risen to the heights together. If Josephine had given him a son, he would have been the happiest man in the world.
As 1806 drew to a close, Napoleon was still at war. Austria and Prussia had both surrendered. But the Russians, bloodied after Austerlitz, and Great Britain, all powerful on the seas, remained dangerous enemies. Against Britain, he made economic warfare, a continental blockade forbidding the European nations to trade with the British Isles. To defeat Russia, he marched his soldiers deep into Poland.
Napoleon's justification is you have to take the war to your adversaries and you have to defeat them, whatever it takes. So going out to the far reaches of Poland, if that's what it takes to get the Russians to capitulate, that's what he's going to do.
Napoleon was in Warsaw when he was stunned by the news of a surprise Russian attack. He struck back at once, first at Eylau, just 130 miles from the Russian border. Then, later, in nearby Friedland. Carnage in both battles was terrible. 70,000 French and Russian soldiers killed or wounded. It is not combat anymore, a Russian general wrote the Tsar. It is butchery. Napoleon's army was torn and bloody. The Tsar's army was in ruins. Alexander puzzled over what to do next.
When Alexander I was thinking about what to do after the Battle of Friedland, his brother Constantine said, "Sire, if you were considering fighting the French, you might as well give each soldier a gun and let him put a bullet in his head. The result will be the same."
On June 25, 1807, Alexander traveled to Tilsit on the western border of the Russian Empire to discuss peace with the Emperor of France. To signify their equal status, they met on a raft moored precisely in the center of the Niemen River, the boundary between Russia and Europe.
When the Tsar met Napoleon, he had one goal in mind, to find a peaceful solution that would benefit him. And the first thing he said to Napoleon in French was, "Sir, I hate the English as much as you do." And Napoleon said, "Then we have made peace."
Napoleon's peace terms were generous. He demanded no Russian territory at all. In return, the Tsar agreed to become France's ally, to join the continental blockade, and refuse to trade with Britain.
Napoleon wanted to have this alliance very much, and he was prepared to sacrifice for it. The alliance of Russia and France, two great empires, would force the British to make peace. Finally, there would be peace in Europe.
Only 10 days before, they had been bleeding each other dry. Now the two old enemies were acting like old friends. The Tsar and Napoleon spent long hours together, inspecting each other's armies, awarding medals to soldiers on both sides. After 2 weeks, the two men seemed to have grown genuinely fond of one another. Napoleon was charmed by Alexander, describing him as especially handsome, like a hero with all the graces of an amiable Parisian. The Tsar, in turn, seemed in awe of Napoleon and his sheer power. As they said goodbye, Napoleon was convinced he had turned the Tsar into a friend and ally. "If Alexander were a woman," he wrote Josephine, "I would make him my mistress."
This was Napoleon's biggest mistake. He thought he actually did charm Alexander. What Napoleon didn't understand was that Alexander would never stick to their agreement. But for Napoleon, the Tilsit peace seemed to be his finest moment, for him and for his empire. He came back to Paris in July 1807 to a huge celebration.
France rejoiced at the signing of the treaty between the two giant powers. Once again, peace in Europe seemed secure. In 1807, Napoleon's empire stretched from the Atlantic coast to the steppes of Russia, from the North Sea to the Mediterranean. He ruled over 70 million people, French, Italians, Dutch, Germans, Poles. There had been no greater empire since the days of Rome. Flushed with the pride of power, he dreamed of uniting all of Europe under French rule.
The defeat of Russia and Prussia was so spectacular. Napoleon was stunned by the success. He never visualized such success. And he began to think, my God, I can do anything.
His rising star had reached its zenith.
At that moment, he begins to believe that he is infallible. A superman. Someone protected by destiny. His famous star. He has complete power in Europe. And his pride is very great. Because this is a former little artillery lieutenant who has made it to the top.
"Ambition is never content," Napoleon once wrote, "even on the summit of greatness." 38 years old, intoxicated with power, the ruler of almost all of Europe, he was bent on one more conquest. It was to be a fatal mistake. In 1808, when Napoleon Bonaparte sent 118,000 soldiers across the Pyrenees into Spain, he imagined they would be welcomed. With my banner bearing the words liberty and emancipation from superstition, he said, I shall be regarded as the liberator of Spain.
Napoleon was convinced that the Spanish people would rise up in a revolution and that he would be acclaimed. He was completely mistaken about the Spanish mentality.
Napoleon could never imagine that some people loved their countries as much as he loved his own. It was a failing compounded by arrogance and pride that would bring about his downfall. Napoleon's economic blockade of Great Britain wasn't working. Defying his command, Spain had been trading with his enemy. Determined to bend the Spanish people to his will, he decided to make Spain a part of his empire.
L'Espagne, à cette époque, était dans un état d'avancement.
Spain at that time was far behind all the other countries in Europe. Napoleon considered the Iberian Peninsula another world, with people from the Dark Ages, dominated by clergy, according to Napoleon, who were illiterate, ignorant, and fanatical. He thought that there would be no resistance whatsoever.
On May 2nd, the Spanish people rose up against the French army in Madrid. By nightfall, 150 French soldiers were dead. The French retaliated. Killing thousands of Spaniards. It was the start of a brutal, no-holds-barred war, marked by savagery on both sides. The French tortured and mutilated their prisoners. The Spanish did the same.
It's a war of atrocities. It's guerrilla war. The word comes from this time. The French army has never fought this kind of war. Not at all the glorious war that they fought elsewhere.
At this point, you begin to see a failure of Napoleon's judgment. He had somehow lost sense of proportion. He gets into Spain, and he won't give up.
Thousands died, but there was no decisive victory. Napoleon would keep his armies in Spain for 5 years, unable to break the will of the Spanish people.
Napoleon n'accepte plus.
Napoleon no longer accepts advice.
Napoleon ne croit plus.
Napoleon only believes in himself. He only has confidence in his star. So he is going to be blinded.
As his empire grew, Napoleon increasingly assumed the part of a Roman Caesar, godlike and infallible. Now he wanted a son to succeed him. But Josephine had never been able to give him one. 46 years old, she knew she never would. I know I will be shamefully dismissed from the bed of the man who crowned me, she told a friend. For months, Napoleon hesitated.
They were a couple very well suited to each other. Up to the end, he believed that Josephine was his lucky star. That's why it was so difficult to divorce her.
At last, he decided to tell Josephine they must sacrifice their marriage for the greater glory of France. 2 weeks later, the divorce became official. "I understood my Bonaparte," Josephine said. "I knew very well that in the end, he would get his way." Josephine went at once to Malmaison. The next day, Napoleon came to see her in the driving rain. Hand in hand, they walked through the downpour. Then he was gone.
Pour elle, c'est fini.
For her, it's over.
Elle ne sera plus l'impératrice.
She will no longer be Empress Josephine.
Mais Napoléon n'a pas non plus
But Napoleon doesn't want this break either.
Il tient à Joséphine, il l'aime.
He's attached to Josephine. He loves her.
Et donc c'est
and it's difficult for him too.
Napoleon gave Josephine Malmaison and an allowance of 3 million francs a year. Now, he was free to find a new wife and father an heir to his throne. "I want," he said, "to marry a womb." He cast his eye on the Archduchess Marie-Louise, the 19-year-old daughter of his old enemy, the Emperor Francis I of Austria. Marriage to Marie-Louise would ally him with the Habsburgs, one of the great reigning families of Europe. But the young woman despised Napoleon. "Just to see the man," she wrote in her diary, "would be the worst form of torture." Her father overruled her objections. Marriage with Napoleon, he told her, would bring Austria peace and an alliance with the most powerful country in Europe. Brought up to obey, the 19-year-old girl said goodbye to her family and headed toward France. On April 2, 1810, Emperor Napoleon Bonaparte married the Archduchess Marie-Louise with all the extravagant display befitting the joining of two empires. "He loves me very much," Marie-Louise wrote her father, "and I respond to his love sincerely. There is something very fetching and very eager about him that is impossible to resist."
Napoleon must have wondered if he was dreaming. He was marrying a Habsburg. He was becoming allied with one of the oldest and most venerable monarchies in Europe.
Just 1 year after their marriage, the thunder of cannon brought all of Paris to attention. Marie-Louise had given birth to a baby boy. Napoleon called him the King of Rome. With a son and a devoted wife, Napoleon seemed transformed. He became a doting father and a loving husband. 42, his stomach swelling into a punch, Napoleon was growing soft. "Late hours, hardship, war are not for me at my age," he told an aide. "I love my bed, my repose, more than anything. But I must finish my work." In 1811, there was still plenty to do. The bloody war in Spain continued. Britain remained a stubborn enemy. And now, a new war threatened. Tsar Alexander refused to be part of the continental blockade of British goods any longer. Napoleon's edict barring trade with Great Britain was ruining the Russian economy. Tensions quickly escalated. Every attempt to negotiate failed. In the spring of 1812, ignoring the advice of his closest advisors, Napoleon invaded Russia. Never in living memory had so large an army been assembled. Italians, Poles, Germans, French. More than 600,000 men from every corner of his empire. Napoleon prophesied that the war would be over in 20 days.
an army of 600,000, it would seem to be absolutely irresistible. No matter what happened, he'll simply pour in enough men to overwhelm the Russians, force them to engage in battle and defeat them.
Napoleon's army trudged slowly across Russia's immense spaces. He hoped to annihilate his enemy at once, but the Russians would not give battle. As the days passed, the blazing heat of the Russian summer began to take its toll. Soldiers fell out from exhaustion, sickness, and desertion. Thousands every day. After 2 months, before Napoleon had fought a single battle, 150,000 soldiers were out of action. At last, with summer ending, the Russians turned and faced their enemy at the crossroads village of Borodino. Moscow, the holy city of Russia, was at stake. The Battle of Borodino was a brutal slugfest. Napoleon threw his enormous army at the Russians in a frontal assault, showing little of his old strategic subtlety.
This was a wild attack. They were killing each other. There were deaths without stop. It was horrific. The battle began at 6:30 in the morning and lasted until 3 in the afternoon. At that point, both armies were exhausted.
The Russians fought the Emperor's armies to a standstill. The next day, they withdrew, leaving Napoleon proclaiming victory. Moscow was at his mercy. But the Russians refused to make peace. As Napoleon's army entered the city, he found it almost deserted. That night, Moscow began to burn. Mountains of red, rolling flames, Napoleon recalled later, like immense waves of the sea. Oh, it was the most grand, the most sublime, and the most terrifying sight the world ever beheld.
The Russians burned Moscow themselves. And when Moscow went up in flames, this was the worst blow to Napoleon's army. Napoleon couldn't stay in Moscow.
Fearing the approach of winter, but reluctant to abandon his conquest, Napoleon wrote the Tsar proposing negotiations. The Tsar responded with icy silence. After 5 weeks of waiting, Napoleon bitterly ordered his soldiers home. On October 19th, he led his men, laden with spoils, out of Moscow through the gate of Kaluga. It was a warm fall day. Three weeks later, it began to snow. The Russian winter had arrived early. Temperatures fell to 22 degrees below zero. Napoleon's soldiers froze in the open countryside. Our lips stuck together, one soldier wrote. Our nostrils froze. We seemed to be marching in a world of ice. Food ran out. Horses died by the thousands. Hungry soldiers quarreled over the horse flesh. They were fighting starvation, cold, fatigue, disease, and the Cossacks. The Cossacks harried Napoleon's flanks, tearing at his army as if it were a wounded animal.
The army is being eaten away because it is being attacked on all sides. So the army fell apart little by little. The French army no longer existed as a fighting force.
Napoleon watched as his army died. Fearing capture, he carried in a little black leather bag tied around his neck a vial of poison. 6 months before, he had crossed into Russia with more than 500,000 soldiers, confident of victory. Now, on December 5th, rumors of a coup in Paris forced him to abandon his troops and head back to the French capital. As his sled made its way across Europe, he told a companion, "It's just one step between the sublime and the ridiculous."
He lost 500,000 men, a staggering sum. Out of the 600,000 men who went in, 93,000 came back.
It was the beginning of the end, his former foreign minister Charles Talleyrand said. Smelling blood, Britain, Prussia, Russia, and Sweden united against him. Only Austria, ruled by his wife's father, wavered. Clinging to the hope that one decisive battle could turn his luck around, Napoleon rallied France for yet another campaign in Central Europe.
He just was fighting here, fighting there, fighting the next place, hopelessly outnumbered. Could never win, but still fighting like mad.
In the fall of 1813, the Allies caught Napoleon at Leipzig, where they outnumbered him 2-1, and punished his armies in a bruising battle that lasted 3 days. The legend of Napoleon's invincibility was over. His armies were now in retreat everywhere in Europe. A year ago, he said, the whole of Europe was marching alongside of us. Today, the whole of Europe is marching against us. In 2 months, he lost 400,000 men. Still, he fought on. There was nothing left to do but fight, he said. Yet every day, our chances grew smaller and smaller. By the beginning of 1814, Napoleon was again in Paris when he learned that the Allies had invaded France itself. Fearing the worst, he began burning his private papers. Even Austria, led by Marie Louise's father, Francis I, had come in for the kill. "Don't worry," Napoleon told his wife and son. "We shall beat Papa Francis. Trust me." On the morning of January 25th, they said goodbye. He would never see his wife or his son again. In a last desperate campaign fought across France, Napoleon displayed all of his old brilliance. But 85,000 Frenchmen stood no chance against 350,000 Allies. On March 31st, 1814, the Allies marched down the Champs-Élysées. The war was all but over. Now, even his own marshals turned against him. When he prepared to summon what remained of his army to march on Paris, they refused to fight any longer. On April 12th, 1814, Napoleon picked up a pen and renounced his throne. "His Majesty appeared to be entirely crushed," his secretary wrote. "His agitation was often so great that, without being aware of it, he tore at his leg with his nails until the blood flowed." That evening, he emptied the contents of a leather pouch into a glass of wine and drank it. The poison failed to kill him. He would live to see everything he had won taken from him. "My father arrived hours ago," Marie-Louise wrote him 2 days later. "He will not let me come to you or see you. I am so sad, I don't know what to tell you. I kiss you, and I love you with all my heart." On April 20th, Napoleon strode down the stairs at Fontainebleau to address his soldiers one last time. "Goodbye, my children. I am leaving. Do not grieve over my fate. I would like to press all of you close to my heart. Let me at least embrace your banner." Then he took a regimental flag in his hands and pressed it to his lips. "Let this kiss," he said, "resonate in the hearts of all my soldiers. Farewell once again. Let this last kiss enter into all your hearts." A British warship carried Napoleon into exile. Just 45 years old, he had won, then lost an empire. As he sailed across the Mediterranean, he came within sight of Corsica. A bitter reminder of how far he had come and how great was his fall. He was given a villa perched on a hillside 100 feet above the sea. Still a sovereign, this would be his new palace, where he was expected to spend the rest of his life. Stripped of his old rank and title, he was granted a new one: Emperor of the Isle of Elba.
When Napoleon arrives on the island of Elba, his first reaction is one of despair, depression, sadness. But he gets over it quickly, and he's able to regain the two aspects of his personality, work and action. He starts taking care of the island of Elba as though it were a great country.
He set up a miniature court, complete with a grand marshal, ministers of the treasury and war, and even a flag of his own devising. He planted olive and mulberry trees, paved the streets, organized a regular collection of garbage, and let it be known that his subjects, the island's 13,000 peasants, should sleep no more than 5 in a bed.
He still had a lot of genius and ability left in him. But it must have been boredom personified.
Napoleon spent his days on horseback, exploring Elba's meager resources. Often he climbed to his favorite spot on the island, a mountain looking out across the Mediterranean. There, he would spend hours gazing toward Corsica. His connections to the past had been severed. When he learned that Josephine had died at Malmaison, he did not leave his room for 2 days. As the weeks passed, Napoleon grew bored playing at Emperor of Elba. He never took his eye off France, where the Allies had made the mistake of restoring an eager but weak Bourbon king to the throne. King Louis XVIII had neither Napoleon's charm or charisma. France had a constitutional monarchy now, but with royalists threatening to abolish the gains of the revolution and the economy floundering, the king soon became unpopular. For 10 months, Napoleon watched and waited. Then on February 26, 1815, he slipped off of Elba with a handful of soldiers and eluded British and French warships. After making a mistake or suffering a misfortune, he said, "The man of genius always gets back on his feet." Once ashore, only the king's army would stand between Napoleon and Paris. 6 days after landing in France, he confronted a regiment of infantry ordered to bar his way. Napoleon advanced alone to meet them. "Soldiers," he cried, "if there is one among you who wants to kill his general, his emperor, here I am." Suddenly, the soldiers began cheering wildly. "Long live the emperor! Long live the emperor!" 2 weeks later, Napoleon was in the French capital, and Louis XVIII had fled. The news hit Europe like a bombshell. The devil, his enemies said, has been unchained.
And again, the mystique of Napoleon. Here's the emperor. Vive l'empereur! They shouted all the way to Paris. But it was really sort of crazy. He hadn't got a hope.
For months after Napoleon's abdication, the Allies had been at odds with one another as they met in Vienna to hammer out an agreement to determine the shape of post-war Europe. Now, Great Britain, Prussia, Austria, and Russia united once again. They declared Napoleon an outlaw, an enemy and a disturber of the tranquility of the world, and readied their armies for war.
All of Europe was against him. There wasn't a chance of France beating this coalition arrayed against it.
By the end of May, the British and Prussians had two armies in Belgium. Austrian and Russian soldiers were on the way. Napoleon's only hope for survival was one last desperate gamble. He planned to drive a wedge between the British and the Prussians and defeat them before the Austrians and the Russians could arrive. Napoleon raised an army and marched toward Waterloo. Napoleon's fate would be decided on a field of rye and clover, 1 mile long and 3 miles wide. Waiting for him was Great Britain's most formidable soldier, the Duke of Wellington.
Tall, aristocratic, rather arrogant, disdainful, not an enormous amount of imagination, but totally unflinching, nerves of steel. He knew his army, and he knew what they would take, and he knew how to deploy them, and he was superlative on the defensive.
Wellington commanded 68,000 men, but he was counting on 72,000 more. The Prussians, led by Marshal Blücher von Ballstadt. Blücher's greatest wish was to capture Napoleon and have him shot. With Blücher and the Prussians by his side, Wellington would outnumber Napoleon 2-1. The Duke impatiently waited for the Prussians to arrive.
Wellington said to Blücher, "The love of God, come as fast as you can. Go fight the last moment to the last man."
But Blücher was still many miles from the battlefield, and Napoleon had sent a sizable force of his own to intercept him. It was not clear whether Blücher would get there on time or at all. The night before the battle, soldiers on both sides caught what sleep they could under a heavy downpour. The next morning, Sunday, June 18th, They were sopping wet. So was the field in which they were to fight, now dotted with puddles and caked in mud. As the sun rose higher in the sky, the Duke and his soldiers braced themselves. But Waterloo remained silent. Nearly 5 hours had passed since daybreak, yet Napoleon had not given the order to attack. He said he was waiting for the ground to dry so he could maneuver his cannon. "I felt that fortune was abandoning me," Napoleon said. "I no longer had the feeling that I was sure to succeed." Finally, at 11:30, Napoleon's artillery opened fire. His battle plan was simple. Wellington's men occupied the outlying farm buildings on both flanks and the crest of a ridge in the center. To break them, Napoleon ordered no elaborate maneuvers. He would stake everything on a massive frontal attack.
He meant to attack Wellington first, and the quicker the better. He thought Wellington would run for his ships. Then he would turn around and blast Blücher.
Shortly after midday, Napoleon ordered a barrage of his most powerful cannon. 74 guns steadily lobbing cannonballs at Wellington's center. But Wellington had ordered his soldiers to take cover behind the crest of the ridge on which they stood, beyond the reach of the French guns.
Napoleon's motto was never attack a man in a prepared position. But here he has no choice. He's got to get Wellington out.
Napoleon's soldiers charged. The British counterattacked, driving the French back in confusion. The French cavalry was destroyed, but the English center appeared on the verge of collapse. The sun hung low in the sky, glowing blood red through the trees and smoke. It was then that Napoleon saw them, Prussian soldiers emerging from the smoke, still in the far distance. He called for the Imperial Guard, the most feared of all his soldiers. Throughout the fighting, he had held them in reserve. Now, he sent them forward. They were just 40 paces away when the Duke gave the order to fire. In less than a minute, 400 Frenchmen fell. Still, the guard came on.
They were absolutely magnificent and came very close. He nearly broke through the British line. But it was too late. The first time in the whole history of the Napoleonic Wars, the guard was seen to falter and then eventually fall back, shouting, "Sauve qui peut," everybody, every man for himself. And then the word ran through the army, "La garde recule," the guard is retreating.
Wellington snapped shut his telescope, took off his hat, and waved it. "No cheering, my lads," he said. "Forward and complete your victory." As the guard fell back, panic spread through the ranks of Napoleon's army. And then disaster was upon them. The Prussians were in the field.
The Prussians really was the last drop of water that tipped the bucket over. Napoleon had to draw forces from his center to deal with Blücher. Blücher won the battle. If Blücher hadn't been there, I don't think Wellington would have made it.
"A damn nice thing," Wellington said later. the nearest run thing you ever saw in your life. The battle had lasted less than 12 hours, a single Sunday afternoon. The field bloody with the wounded and the dead, Napoleon tried in vain to rally his men, then turned his back on the catastrophe and escaped. With all of Europe against him, Napoleon saw the futility of going on. As Allied armies closed in around him, he let events run their course. On June 22, 1815, 4 days after the Battle of Waterloo, he abdicated his throne for the second time. With no hope of escape, he put himself at the mercy of Great Britain. He wished, he said, to reside in a country house near London. The British turned him down. Instead, they sent him back into exile. This time, they took no chances that he would return. Allowing him a small group of loyal followers, they chose a far-flung outpost of their empire, a slab of volcanic rock in the South Atlantic Ocean, one of the most remote places on Earth, St. Helena.
When Napoleon sees this fortress for the first time, he understands everything. He knows at this moment, this is going to be his grave.
Once the ruler of nearly all of Europe, Napoleon found himself confined to an island 10 miles long, 6 miles wide. It would be nice, he told an aide, to fall asleep and not wake up for a year or two. On Elba, he had at least been an emperor. On St. Helena, he was a prisoner, guarded by 2,000 soldiers and two ships that circled the island 24 hours a day. His final palace would be a wooden bungalow that had once been a row of cattle stalls. He was 46 years old, with nothing to do for the rest of his life but eat, sleep, and search for a way to occupy his mind. To die is nothing, he said, but to live defeated and without glory is to die every day. Stripped of every vestige of power, on this windswept island lost in the Atlantic, Napoleon fought the endless boredom of his days. He gardened, read any book or newspaper he could get his hands on, tried rewriting a tragedy of Voltaire's, imposed an exacting imperial etiquette on his retinue, and sparred with the island's English governor, who insisted on calling Napoleon General Bonaparte. When he was unable to sleep, he would summon one of his retainers in the middle of the night and rant about the world or explain why he lost the Battle of Waterloo. Only one weapon remained him, words. With words, he would launch his last campaign. Day after day, he dictated his memoirs, forging the story of his life into the stuff of legend. I shall survive, he said, and whenever they want to strike a lofty attitude, they will praise me.
Il avait pendant ces jours-là décidé que sa vie.
He had decided during this time that his real life had ended, but that now his legendary life would begin, and that he had to take care of it.
He re-argued his decisions and re-fought his battles, recalling his greatest triumphs for all the world to admire. Rivoli, the pyramids, Marengo, Austerlitz. These are granite, he said. The tooth of envy is powerless there. The Civil Code, the Bank of France, the bridges over the Seine, schools, roads, canals, libraries. He made them all bear witness to his enduring legacy.
He reconstructs his actions to justify his choices, to say that he was the savior of the revolution, to say that he wanted peace, to say that he wanted a new world, and that the kings of Europe were opposed to a modern man, a man of action who was working for the good of the people.
He had little else to do but fight the battle of his image, of his reputation. And it was an extremely successful campaign. What is conveyed in this is an individual who can accomplish so much, so very much, through determination and energy and intelligence. This is his sense of himself.
As time wore on, his health failing, Napoleon at last gave way to boredom and then despair.
He really felt this sadness falling little by little, like a drop of acid which finally corrodes your soul. I believe it was this that killed Napoleon.
Napoleon lasted 5.5 years on St. Helena. On May 5th, 1821, he died, deliriously whispering, "France, Army, Chief of Army, Josephine." He was 51 years old. As he had willed it, his life entered into the world's imagination. Even his exile became a glorious martyrdom. St. Helena, his crown of thorns, the last station of his cross. "My downfall," he said, "raises me to infinite heights."
Napoleon considered it necessary to present himself as a martyr. He said, "If Christ hadn't been crucified, he would never have been God."
As the years passed, his story told and retold, the love of power, the tyrannical nature of his rule, and the 3 million soldiers who had died in wars that had brought him glory, did nothing to tarnish the brilliance of the legend he had created.
Napoleon, through his writing, was able to create loyal, fervent followers. It's extraordinary.
Tour de baguette magique.
With the wave of a magic wand, from a defeated prisoner, he becomes a hero again. He becomes the one who writes history. He doesn't die. He will never die.
Il ne mourra jamais.
"Everything on earth is soon forgotten," Napoleon said, "except the opinion we leave imprinted on history. There is no immortality but the memory that is left in the minds of men."